أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين Dear brothers and sisters, I am grateful to ICNA for giving me this opportunity to speak on a subject which has acquired great importance these days because of the financial crisis in the United States which has spread throughout the world. The prevailing crisis is the most severe link in the chain of crises over the last four decades. In fact, it is the most serious crisis in living memory. This raises the question of whether something can be done to minimize the frequency and severity of such crises in the future. Because this is not possible without first analyzing the primary cause of the crisis. So, what is the primary cause? The cause which is cited by most scholars is excessive and imprudent lending. In the annual report of the Bank for International Settlements last year, they cited the same cause, excessive and imprudent lending. So this again raises another question of why is it possible for banks to resort to excessive and imprudent lending? Aren't they afraid of making losses ultimately and getting into a situation of bankruptcy? Or is there inadequate regulation and supervision? Maybe there is another cause, which is the fault line in the whole financial system, necessitating a structural change in the financial system. Next. Has the financial system failed on both accounts, that is inadequate market discipline and inadequate regulation and supervision? And if so, what is the reason? When does a financial system operate effectively? Because this question relates to the market system itself. When does the market system operate effectively? And why is it considered to be very effective and efficient? This is because in the market system, there are incentives and deterrents. If you take the right decisions and operate in a proper way, you will make profit. And if you take wrong decisions and do not operate in an effective manner, you will suffer losses. So, doesn't this system of incentives and deterrents operate in the financial system? The answer is no, it does not operate. So, the question is, what is it that enables the financial system to lead to excessive lending and imprudent lending? Is it collateral? No, not necessarily, because collateral is necessary and it is required even in the Islamic financial system. But collateral can provide effective protection only if it's evaluated properly. If the banks do not have fear of loss, then they may not evaluate the collateral effectively and extend loans excessively. So while collateral is necessary, it does not provide effective protection to the financial system. Then what is it that does provide the protection to the financial system? One of the innovations that got introduced in the financial system over the last couple of decades is the sale of debt. In other words, you lend to somebody and then you pass on the risk to someone else through the sale of debt. It is the other person who has purchased the debt who is going to suffer the loss in case of default. So the bank has nothing to worry about. Lend as much as you can and then sell the debt and pass the risk to someone else. Because this had a problem associated with it. If you try to sell a debt, people would be willing to buy prime debt but not a subprime debt. So what do you do to overcome this difficulty? There was another innovation, and this was securitization. You combine the prime and subprime debts together and securitize them, sell them in small packages to the purchasers. Collateralized debt obligations or asset-backed securities. There was thus a mixing of prime and subprime debt. If there was transparency and people knew what exactly they were getting into, there may not have been any problem. But there was no transparency and people bought collateral debt obligations without knowing what they were getting into. This essentially means that there was some kind of a fraud going on in the transactions. There were another kind of fraud which also persisted, and this was due to the teasing rates. In adjustable mortgage rates, you can indicate a lower rate of interest in the beginning to attract people to borrow, and then after a few installments, you raise the rate of interest to a very high level, making it very difficult for people to make payments. There was again fraud here. If somebody had checked this fraud, probably there may not have been any problem. There was another innovation which helped provide protection to banks and induced them to lend excessively. And this was the emergence of credit default swaps. When this is a kind of insurance. If I buy a car, I want to insure it so that whenever there is an accident, I will be protected by the insurance company. But in the case of car insurance, only the person who owns the car and is driving or has allowed someone else to drive, then he is protected. In case of an accident, he gets compensation, but no one else can get compensation. But in the case of these credit default swaps, there were a large number of other people who bought swaps against default of that particular individual, which means that if the borrower defaulted, then there was not only the creditor, actual person who has lent to this borrower, but a large number of others who will also claim compensation. this raised the risk to a very great extent. It means that it combined business with wagering or gambling. If because of this there was the credit default swaps increased to a very high level, the total number of derivatives in the outstanding derivatives in June 2008 amounted to $684 trillion. This amount may not give you any idea of how large it was until we look compare it with the total GDP. The total GDP were in 2007 was only $54 trillion. In other words, the derivatives were 12 times the total amount of GDP of the world, and most of this amount was of course due to wagering and gambling. When there was a boom and there were few defaults, there was no problem. The hedge funds or the banks were able to compensate without difficulty. But when the market started going down, and when in this downturn the number of defaults increased, it was not possible for banks or the hedge funds to compensate. They failed, many of them failed, and there was the financial crisis. So there was excessive lending combined with a great deal of fraud, lack of transparency and gambling. Then there was also a failure on the part of rating agencies. They had a vested interest in the banks or the hedge funds, and therefore they did not evaluate the data they received from them. They gave high ratings to all these securities, and people therefore purchased them, and the securities were not as good as the ratings indicated, and people therefore got cheated. There is also the concept of too big to fail, which means that the central bank is ultimately going to come to the help of the large banks in case they have any problem. Therefore, there is no need to be too cautious in lending. You can lend as much as you can, and therefore you will be able to increase your profits and be able to give the fantastic salaries that the CEOs were getting. But while all this was going on, what were the supervisors doing? If the supervisors had been very cautious, maybe the crisis may not have taken place. But they were not very cautious because of the Enlightenment philosophy. Mr. Greenspan, who ruled the roost in the Federal Reserve for a long time, he believed in the Enlightenment philosophy, liberalism. In other words, they should not put any checks on the market, allow the market to go on, the market would itself create discipline. But the market was not able to do that, create the discipline, and therefore the crisis arrived. So there were a number of things that enabled the banks to resort to excessive and imprudent lending.